Hello, wrestling fans, and welcome to this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling, another tremendous card, and we want you to stay with us all the way. I'm Boyd Pierce, your host, and remember, we're going to have a special challenge match. It'll be Colonel Buck Robley in the ring against General Skandar Akbar, and Killer Khan and the one-man gang are barred from the ring during this match. Also, Mississippi Heavyweight Champion Mr. Olympia is here, Mr. Wrestling 2, the North American Heavyweight Champion Ted DiBiase, and also a man that you want to look for. We're looking forward to it, that will establish himself upon the minds of any of us in professional wrestling, Kamala, the Ugandan Giant. And now our guest commentator, one of the most knowledgeable men in professional wrestling, Cowboy Bill Watts. Bill?
Well, thank you, Boyd Pearson. Of course, Kamala, the Ugandan Giant. I was asking Reeser Bowden if he'd guesstimated his size and weight, because the guy wasn't speaking any English that we know of, and he came in here with a second that is completely, his identity is not disclosed, and Reeser said the guy looks like he's in excess of 6'7" and over 385 pounds, and I take it Reeser can guesstimate pretty close because he's been looking at these heights and weights for a long time. But Boyd Pierce, another great thing, the Junkyard Dog, the man that everywhere he goes, he is the biggest attraction they've ever had because of his great heart and courage. Houston, Texas, the 24th of September. You were there. You were right. The guest announcer. Let's join that match as you announce it, the Junkyard Dog versus Nick Bockwinkel of the City Auditorium in Houston.
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Always a pleasure to be back in Houston, Texas. We also thank you for watching Mid-South Wrestling. We hope that you'll enjoy professional wrestling, the world's most exciting professional sport. This event, one fall to a finish with no time limit, in the ring at 240 pounds from Beverly Hills, California, Nick Bockwinkel. The Junkyard Dog. One fall to a finish, no time limit. Your referee, Jack Howe.
Bill Watts here as we join this super spectacular event in Houston, Texas at the City Auditorium. Nick Bockwinkel, the AWA World's Heavyweight Champion, the Junkyard Dog, the man that was crowned by unanimous petition, the King of Wrestling in Houston, Texas, where you heard Boyd Pierce, who was there as the guest announcer that night, say, right there on Channel 39 in Houston, you can watch Mid-South Wrestling along with Paul Bosch and Peter Burkholz find Best of Texas Wrestling, and it's a great, great evening. The man who is the superstar of the country today, the Junkyard Dog in this headline bout, Nick Bockwinkel, the AWA World's Heavyweight Champion. One thing, Bobby the Brain Heenan, Nick Bockwinkel's associate manager, has been barred for this event. Bockwinkel is after the Junkyard Dog's crown. He says if he beats the dog tonight, the dog has to forfeit the crown to him. Of course, the dog, referring to the weasel Bobby Heenan, said if Bobby Heenan shows up, I'm going to stick him in his weasel suit, put my dog collar on him, and parade him around the City Auditorium in Houston. Jack Howe, referee, both men collar and elbow. Tie up. Bockwinkel. Looks like he's hitting a stone wall right there as he starts the heavy forearms on the Junkyard Dog. The dog, oh, that one really caught him, right to the jaw. A Junkyard Dog, a man who is a headliner wherever he goes. Bockwinkel, of course, a AWA World's Champion, campaigns mostly Chicago, Minneapolis, Winnipeg, Denver, Oakland, Germany. An international star, a man who's been a top main eventer for many years, a very seasoned veteran. So you have the experience going against just brute raw force and courage of the Junkyard Dog. Jack Howe trying to call for the break on the ropes. Paul Bosch and Peter Burkholz always bring the best wrestling to Texas at the City Auditorium. Dog powers out. He bench pressed 560 pounds. It's hard to keep him on the mat for that 3-second count unless you really got him wrapped up. Headbutt. Like I say, Nick Bockwinkel is now finding what every top wrestler who has faced the dog has found. What a formidable object it is to go against JYD. Here a clothesline. Both men were shaken. Jack Howe counting them, giving a 10 count to gain their feet. Bockwinkel back up to the attack. Looked like a low shot there. I couldn't tell if that was a karate shot or not. Jack Howe counting as the dog is out on the apron. Bockwinkel still attacking the throat. So it must have been a karate shot, and he's trying to capitalize on it. Jack Howe counting. Bockwinkel not seeming to care about the rules. His title's not at stake. He wants to decrown the Junkyard Dog, the man who by popular acclaim and a huge petition was crowned King of Wrestling in Houston, Texas by Paul Bosch, the venerable promoter. Junkyard Dog fighting his way back into the ring. And I think Bockwinkel just is completely discouraged a little bit. He's put the heavy artillery on JYD, and it hasn't slowed him down. It hadn't made him look even like he was in serious trouble. And that's discouraging when you face that awesome power. Oh, the big thump. JYD has him up. There, he just drove him in that hard floor of that City Auditorium ring. And Bockwinkel still coming up. JYD is just going to give it to him again. It looks like he's there goes a howl. Headbutt. New York Ring magazines are there taking photographs of this important bout. The thump again, the big thump. And you see the Japan newspaper there taking pictures. And the JYD wins again, beats Nick Bockwinkel, the American Wrestling Association World Heavyweight Champion.
Dog in another outstanding match, proving once again that wherever he is, he's undeniably the people's choice. We'll be back now with a special challenge match, Colonel Buck Robley versus Kandor Akbar, after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
And now a special challenge match, and you will notice that Killer Khan and the One Man Gang are not in the auditorium. They have been banned from the arena. This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. At 260 pounds, a former North American heavyweight champion, General Skandor Akbar. And at 242 pounds from Amarillo, Texas, Buckley Christopher George Robley III.
And the special challenge match, Rick Ferreira calling him in to the center, calls for the bell. Colonel Buck Robley against General Skandor Akbar, and he's in there alone because his two big men of his stable is out, barred from the match, Bill Watts.
Well, of course, this is a battle of survival between Buck Robley and General Akbar. And Akbar's man, the one-man gang, was against Buck here last week in a lumberjack-style match where Buck won the match. He got the right for this match with Skandor Akbar, and Buck beat the one-man gang here. Probably a lot of knowledgeable people thought that was a great upset, but I've learned that over the years you can never count Buck Robley down until he's out because he's a competitor. And now he's got the general in there, and this is something he's really wanted. It's just almost like who's going to dominate Mid-South between these two men. Arm bar by Buck, uses that leverage to flying mare Akbar over. Akbar, a powerful man, strong bench presser, shows that strength in kicking out. And of course, Akbar was a former North American champion. And he says that he can do what the men in his stable can't do, that he can personally get rid of Buck. Double arm bar. Akbar using those tights to push him into the ropes to force the break. Now watch if he tries to hit Robley on the break. There he goes into those short ribs. Kind of a chopping maneuver right under the ribs. It'll take that wind out of Akbar. And in this business, as in any sport, your octane or your gasoline is how much wind you can and air you can get into those lungs. And without it, you can't go. Front face lock by Akbar. A man who says he uses the portraits of Ben Franklin
and that's on a $100 bill to get his wishes carried out, and he's not afraid to spend that money. You got to spend money to make money, he says. Inside cradle by Robley. Agbar kicks out, up collar and elbow into the ropes for the break again. Ferrar calling the break. Agbar again hitting on the break. Forearm smashes. Buck Robley firing back. And Buck really taking it to Skandar Akbar. He's got the sleeper. Buck's got the sleeper on Akbar. The people applauding. They know that Buck Robley's got the sleeper on Skandar Akbar. Somebody just ran by.
Went by the table, Bill.
The man's in a sheepskin jacket. He's attacking Buck Robley from behind. Apparently, Skandar Akbar again has used those Ben Franklins to hire another assassin. And that one is the Mongolian Stomper. The man managed by Carson. And he has attacked Colonel Buck Robley from behind. Double chop. And he picks Robley up. And there's that hold of his, the Shinolonamaki, which is a form of sleeper, just as the one Buck has, by this powerful man, this unscrupulous, heartless individual, the Mongolian Stomper. There Jesse Barr comes to his rescue. Stomper knocked Jesse Barr off. Vinnie Romeo, Mike Bond. Look at this man decimate these troops that have come to try to help Colonel Robley. And Skandar Akbar has apparently reached out into those purse strings and found another vicious, unscrupulous animal to do his bidding.
And Bill, we'll be back with more action after we pause for this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the blue corner at 218 pounds from Knoxville, Tennessee, Tim Horner. Coming into the ring right now at somewhere in excess of 6 feet, 8 inches tall, and somewhere in excess of 385 pounds from Uganda, Kamala, the Ugandan giant.
As the introduction, Tim Horner in the green tights, held back by referee Jerry Usher. And the far side, we see Kamala, the Ugandan giant. Bill?
Oh boy, I don't know. I'm sitting here flabbergasted just like you are. We'd seen the advance promotional on this man, and we still don't know who controls him, because as you can see, his valet or his second there is completely masked. He's in camouflage gear. As I said before, Reese Bowden had guessed him, looks like about 6 foot eight and 385 pounds. He's from Uganda. We're told that he's not a skilled technician as far as wrestling goes, that he's just a mean, tough, rugged individual that uses that size and that strength, and he'll fight. And of course, at least they have restricted that spear to a ceremonial spear without a steel head on it. There's no telling what he'd do with that. Tim Horner, I'm sure, is looking on, is very curious too, that he's the first to face the man here on Mid-South Wrestling on television. By the way, that last match with Buck Robley was a disqualification of Akbar. I'm sure that doesn't bother Akbar. Big, huge man. He's got the earrings apparently in his ears and his nose. And Usher calls for the bell, and here comes this big, huge man. Oh, all that power. And he's really hitting Horner. Boy, I don't know what to anticipate here. I don't know what his favorite moves are. You and I will just have to watch, but he's certainly got the power. Look at him. He's just treating Tim Horner, who weighs some 218, 220 pounds, like a rag doll. And as he looks like when he pats his belly there, it could almost remind you of thinking about in Africa when a cannibal was getting ready to devour a missionary or something, because this man is undoubtedly a savage individual. Oh, he really, look at him, he's just wiping out Tim Horner. He made short work of that young man.
Wiped out he did. We saw the debut of the awesome Kamala, the Ugandan giant, with a victory. We'll be right back when Mid-South Wrestling returns after this message.
It's tag team action now for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at a total combined weight of 485 pounds, the Grappler and his partner, Grappler number two. In the blue corner, at a 238 pounds from New York City, Vinnie Romeo. And his partner at 236 pounds from Portland, Oregon, Jesse Barr.
Tag team action now been introduced. Vinnie Romeo in the red tights, his partner Jesse Barr, red, white, and blue jacket, as he just stated, against not one, but two masked grapplers. Bill?
Well, this will definitely be a fast-paced match. There's some guys in there can really move. And you know, boy, Pierce, a lot of things have been happening the last few weeks. It seems like every time that Superdome rolls close, and Thanksgiving night is the day of the next Superdome in November the 25th in New Orleans, it seems like a lot of things start happening. And you know, when Buck had Akbar up against the wall and I saw this Kamala, this Ugandan giant, come in, and we don't know who controls him, who signs these matches, or who handles his money yet, I started thinking maybe that Akbar had something to do with it and he was there to get Buck, since the one-man gang in Killer Khan was barred. But then the Stomper, and I was only familiar with his hold because I've seen him in Houston. As you know, Mid-South and the best of Texas wrestling in Houston combined there to give that great city some of the greatest cards ever in that whole part of the country. And I've seen the Stomper in battles with Dick Slater and with Tony Atlas. But apparently Skandar Akbar bought his contract or paid money to Don Carson, his manager, and had him here to get to Buck Robley. So you can never count General Akbar out either, and he'll go to any extreme. And here we have Vinnie Romeo and Jesse Barr against the Grapplers, but I'm still a little bit in shock at the way the huge monster of a man, Kamala, destroyed Tim Horner. Don't know who he's after, but it's certainly, sooner or later, they all go after the Junkyard Dog, because he's the man wherever he goes. And he's the one they want to try to whip, because they know if they're in there and can beat him, they're going to make the money. Of course, Mr. Wrestling 2, Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch, and Colonel Buck Robley, and Mr. Olympia and Iron Mike Sharp are the others in the Mid-South area that make it tick. These are the contests that matchmaker Grizzly Smith has to decide when they go to the individual arenas. And here's two other men that are trying to climb the ladder to that Mid-South tag team title, the Grapplers. And of course, the Grappler already has tried to make a fool of Mr. Wrestling 2. And he claims that he can use Mr. 2's knee lift better than Wrestling 2. And that's adding insult to injury. And I'll guarantee you, he better hope that his head is screwed on tight, because Wrestling 2 will knee lift it right off for him. Jesse Barr fighting back there. Mr. Olympia up next, who regained his Mississippi title September the 22nd in Jackson, Mississippi, by defeating Killer Khan. You know, he lost that title in Shreveport, Louisiana, and asked for the rematch back in the state of Mississippi and regained that title. Fast tag made here. These two grapplers are a very agile team. They've also got to contend with DiBiase and Hacksaw Dugan being the number one contenders. And last week, we saw them double up on Mr. Olympia. We saw Dick Murdoch and the Junkyard Dog answer that challenge, and it went off the end of television airtime last week with no winner, and that was a battle. You fans at home missed it. Those here at the Irish McNeil Boys Club are fortunate enough to see about another 10 minutes of that action. Vinnie Romeo showing that he's improving. High drop kick. He's showing the quickness and the speed. He's trimmed off a little weight in the gym. He's moving a lot quicker out there, and it's really showing. Grappler number two sidestepped him. Got him in a backbreaker. Tony Atlas will be here. We'll show you some filmed highlights of one of the most powerful men in the world, Mr. USA. There goes the grappler. Oh, Vinny Romeo's arm had to feel that pain. The grappler twist, top wrist lock, and the count.
What's more tougher than one grappler? It's two grapplers, and they're victorious in this tag team match. We'll be back right after this word from Mid-South Wrestling with more action.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 275 pounds from the Big Sky Country of Montana, Rick the Hangman Harris. And in the blue corner at 242 pounds, the man who, after defeating Killer Khan in Jackson, Mississippi on September 22nd, second-time holder of the Mississippi Heavyweight Champion, Mr. Olympia.
Mr. Olympia being introduced as Mississippi Heavyweight title holder against the Hangman, Rick Harris. Bill?
Okay, good match. I know Mr. Olympia is excited. Rick Harris has been off of Mid-South Wrestling for some time. Olympia uses that quick speed. A very controversial situation around that Mississippi title, with Killer Khan winning it in Shreveport in a special sanctioned match in the state of Louisiana. Then Mr. Olympia getting the rematch in Jackson, Mississippi on the 22nd, and Akbar again interfering and again trying to cause a disqualification. But this time the disqualification didn't stand. The commission in Mississippi declared Mr. Olympia the Mississippi champion. He's back here, he's fired up. Here's a young man that went out last week at the dog, had finished wrestling, was in the shower, and DiBiase and Dugan were out there wanting tougher competition and challenging him. And he told him he'd go get JYD out of the shower, and they jumped him and pretty well worked him over. And before JYD was even aware of it, then JYD got Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch from Waxahachie, Texas, one of the toughest men ever walked on 2 feet. And they went out, and let me tell you, it turned into a tornado tag team, barn-burning fist fight out here with all four men in the ring at the same time. No rules, no regulations. We ran out of television time, and they still couldn't get the men separated. It went on in here for about 10 minutes, Boyd, after we were off the air, before they just finally, the combatants almost just beat each other senseless. Mr. Olympia, man who's been the Junkyard Dog's partner, been loyal to him, Mid-South Tag Team Champions. And they've really been having to fight some battles with DiBiase and Dugan. And then when they had Mr. Wrestling 2 seemingly signed a special referee, and the grappler was duplicating Mr. Wrestling 2, fortunately Grizzly Smith sent the telegram to Atlanta to Mr. Wrestling 2's post office box to confirm it. And Mr. Wrestling 2 said something stinks down there, and he came and showed up and caught him in the midst of it. A lot of wild things happening. Mr. Olympia coming up next, Tony Atlas, one of the strongest men in the world, a man that can bench press 600 pounds, can do five repetitions with 500 pounds. It's in the Mr. USA contest this weekend in New York City. Tremendous move by Mr. Olympia. Sleeper. He's got it. The crowd comes to its feet.
And the sleeper gains a victory for the champion of the state of Mississippi, Mr. Olympia. We'll be back and see Mr. USA Tony Atlas in action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
Well, Boyd Pierce, thanks to Channel 39 in Houston, Texas, we're going to hear from one of the most powerful young men in wrestling today, Mr. USA Tony Atlas, a man who can bench press 600 pounds, can do five repetitions with 500 pounds on the bench press. It's our pleasure now. Let's listen to Peter Burkholz talk to Tony Atlas.
You wrestling fans of Mid-South Wrestling, Tony Atlas, Mr. USA, is returning to your area, one of the greatest wrestlers in the sport today, one of the most exciting wrestlers to watch in action.
Well, all day I got to say, my main man, Junkyard Dog, he told me, he said, look, Tony, things are getting a little bit out of hand here in the Mid-South. We want you to come down here, Tony, and do your thing like you know how to do it. So in the Mid-South, one Tony Atlas is coming, and he ain't coming to play around. He ain't coming to shuck and jab. He's coming for business, brother, to take care of business. TCB, to get down and to get funky like I never got funky before. In the Mid-South, I hear they got some of the greatest professional wrestlers in the world today. And the reason that I'm coming down there is one reason only, is to show them who is one of the men who will stand up to them and fight them tooth and nail. Junkyard Dog said, Tony, I can't do it by myself. I need my good friend to come down here and help me whoop on some of these sorry, good-for-nothing bad guys in the Mid-South. So all you boys in the Mid-South, get ready for yourself, because I got trouble here, and I got trouble there, and I got trouble coming your way to the Mid-South. We gonna boogie, baby. We gonna get down. Everybody come out and get on down in the Mid-South.
Now you heard from Tony. Let's join him in action against one of the great superstars from Mexico, one of the toughest men ever out of Mexico, Gran Marcus, in the final moments of a match that had gone some 30 minutes. Let's join that last bit of action in Houston, Texas.
As you heard from Tony Atlas earlier, he's on the way to the Mid-South area. Now we join him in the final moments of a long and grueling battle in Houston, Texas, against one of the toughest athletes Mexico has ever produced, El Gran Marcus. A man who's renowned throughout the world and the leader of the banner of wrestlers that have gained such international fame out of Mexico. Men like Mil Mascaras, Chavo Guerrero, and then Gran Marcus, and he's against Mr. USA, young Tony Atlas, the most powerful, tremendously built individual, a man who has competed in the Mr. USA contest. Referee Danny Pletches. The final moments there, you see old Gran Marcus go for something, and it looks like he has put a foreign object into his mask and to try to beat Tony Atlas. It looked like he almost kicked him in the shins there to try to get his attention away from that, and he's headbutting him, and Atlas is groggy. This is a match that had lasted about 40 minutes at this point. We're just joining the final closing moments, and he's trying to put Atlas away, but everything he hits Atlas with, he just can't seem to get him down for the count. This man is a very powerful man, a friend of the Junkyard Dog. Atlas leaped clear over. Look at that tremendous spring of that drop kick. And Atlas is up shucking and jiving and moving on. And El Gran Marcus headbutt. The headbutt, the object must still be in there because it really stunned Tony. But now Tony's up and leaps into the air. Referee Danny Pletches counting the fall, and Mr. USA, Tony Atlas, a victor in this grueling match in Houston. And
boy, a great victory for that young man, and he'll be here on Mid-South Wrestling in the very near future. Now let's go to Reeser Bowden in the ring to introduce this next bout.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 265 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, the North American heavyweight champion, Ted DiBiase. And in the blue corner at 245 pounds from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike Bond.
Mike Bond shedding his red jacket, and you heard the boos that greeted the introduction of the North American heavyweight champion, Ted DiBiase.
Well, certainly DiBiase wanted to be number one, and he is number one. He is the North American champion. And that creates a lot of intensity. I just wonder if it's worth it to Ted DiBiase when he looks at himself in that mirror each night to shave or in the morning, as to have lost probably the best friend he could have ever had, the Junkyard Dog, and that the Junkyard Dog was a victim of his treachery in order to get to number one, because DiBiase used to be a young man that earned his position. He had held the North American title before, and he was a youngster that Dick Murdoch, Terry Funk, Dory Funk, the greats out of West Texas, thought had such a great future. And all these people are disappointed. Dick Murdoch's disgusted. And Ted DiBiase now has used apparently some of the tactics that he's learned that were used against him over the years. And certainly there was no more subtle or treacherous way in which he double-crossed the Junkyard Dog. And it's become a battle of survival in Mid-South between DiBiase and Dog. Each wants to complete dominance over the other. Of course, DiBiase feels that if he can get the Mid-South Tag Team titles off the Dog will be embarrassed and be forced to leave the Mid-South area. And the Dog wants to regain the North American title that was so wrongfully taken from him. He had won back the Louisiana title and had vacated that in a tournament at the request of Mid-South. And then DiBiase double-crossed him. And of course, DiBiase is now put in his alliance with Hacksaw Dugan, a man who has no regard for his own personal safety, that'll do DiBiase's beck and call and sacrifice himself, and they've become an awesome team. A tremendous amount of controversy, and then DiBiase even tried to duplicate Mr. Wrestling 2 and use the man's international reputation as a rugged man, but a man of fair play, in asking for him to be the special referee when Mr. Wrestling 2 had not been informed of it. But fortunately, Grizzly Smith uncovered it by accident. And Wrestling 2 being the man of honor he has had come here. And the grappler was the man in the complicity. And you hear the crowd shout, "We want the Dog, we want the Dog." Next week here on Mid-South, Ted DiBiase and Hacksaw Dugan will go against Iron Mike Sharp and Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch. And that should be a barn burner. Don't forget to tune in. That's another one of those great matches that Grizzly Smith, the matchmaker, always puts together. And of course, Boyd, you'll have Bob Roop, who is certainly a qualified individual as your guest commentator. Junkyard Dog and Mr. Olympia will be here. The Ugandan Giant, the Mongolian Stomper. It's all starting to boil down, and get ready for Thanksgiving in New Orleans at the Superdome. Little Rock, Arkansas, been on fire there. Tulsa, Oklahoma, Oklahoma City, the beautiful Myriad Center. Power slam. And DiBiase victorious again.
And we'll be back, Mr. Wrestling 2, the popular star from Atlanta, Georgia, in action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
We've been unable to get Ted DiBiase out of the ring.
In this next match, my partner and I came out here a week ago and refused to leave this ring. And I'm refusing to leave this ring until I clear the air for about a few things. Now, I'm sick and tired of Mid-South showing favoritism to certain individuals. My partner and I physically beat up Mr. Olympia last week. He had to be carried from this ring. And here comes the Junkyard Dog and Dick Murdoch, like knights in shining armor, to the rescue. But what the people didn't see, because we went off the air, what the people didn't see was my partner and I annihilate the Junkyard Dog and Dick Murdoch. Physically beat him up and embarrass him right here on television. And Mid-South continues to sign contracts with me to defend the North American title against these two guys. I can't understand that. If they were both here, if either one of them were here, I'd bring him back in the ring right here today and settle this thing and whip him for all you people to see. Yeah, Wrestling 2, you come in here. I got something to say to you too. Yeah, get your tail in here too. You're another one. You're another one been going around Mid-South telling everybody that you think I'm the instigator. I'm the one that instigated this thing between you and the grappler. That I'm the one that instigated him coming out here and using your knee and your mask and physically and publicly embarrassing you. Well, let me tell you something. I don't have to do that. The grappler didn't like you anyway. I think he's got a better knee than you. And he didn't try to embarrass you, mister. He did embarrass you. And the other thing, here you are coming down out of Atlanta, supposed to be my friend, telling everybody how disappointed you are that I've changed my style, coming here to be an unbiased official, and tried to cause my partner and I to lose the Mid-South Tag Team titles. Well, you're in the ring right now. So if you want to go ahead and take a shot at me, because I am a wrestling champion, you got your chance right now. We don't have to wait till we get to an arena. We don't have to wait till we get to the arena too. We'll do it right here, and I'll show you and you and all of you people that I'm the North American champion, and I'm proud of it. Number one, number two.
Well, hey, DiBiase, I don't see no anchor around your leg, so if you want to get it on now, brother, let's do it. Okay, it looks like that's the way it is. Ted DiBiase at 265 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska. And at 236 pounds from Atlanta, Mr. Wrestling 2. This event is one fall or remaining television
time. Jerry Usher called for the bell, Bill.
Oh, boy, Pierce, you hear the crowd going two, 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 two. And Ted DiBiase has just run his alligator mouth into another confrontation here on Mid-South Wrestling. And I'll guarantee you, he's picked on somebody that will stick you. Mr. Wrestling 2, like fine wine. He's like Kenny Stabler of the New Orleans Saints. The longer he sticks in it, the better he gets. He's got all that knowledge and all that courage. George Blanda, great competitor, past his prime, everybody thought, and yet he led the Oakland Raiders to many a championship, just as Kenny Stabler did, just as Wrestling 2. And DiBiase, I couldn't help but overhear him say that he and Hacksaw Dugan had humiliated Junkyard Dog and Dick Murdoch. Boy, although it went off the air and the fans at home didn't see it, I don't think you and I saw it exactly that way. Only 3 minutes of airtime left in this impromptu contest. And Wrestling 2 inviting him back in. You know, Grizzly Smith doesn't step out and try to stop things like this because he says these guys are over 21, they're professionals, let them settle their own differences in the ring. And I couldn't concur with him more heartily because I think when somebody challenges somebody in the ring, they ought to be able to, you know, if the whole world had a way of isolating people with differences and putting a pair of boxing gloves on them or getting them in a gymnasium and let them get all their frustrations taken out on each other, these prisons would be a lot less crowded because you'd have people that would settle their differences and then they would probably be able to walk up and down the street and not break all the laws. Arm drag, Wrestling 2, a quick man, DiBiase moving, two going for that knee, and DiBiase knew it, and he bailed out. Ted DiBiase may have bitten off more than he could chew. And of course, next week, he and Hacksaw Dugan will face Dick Murdoch and Iron Mike Sharp, the Louisiana champion. 2 minutes of airtime left, Boyd Pierce. We weren't able to see to a completion last week's brutal battle between DiBiase and Hacksaw Dugan and JYD and Captain Redneck. We'll stay to it until airtime is exhausted with this contest, this challenge match. Both men trying to lock up, tremendous wrist strength, shoulder strength, leaning into each other. DiBiase with that black glove over that taped hand that he so aptly used, where he said Bob Roop had injured the hand. He had doctor's permission to wear the tape over it. 1 minute airtime left. Boyd Pierce, this contest, I want to ask Oral Link, who's back there in the truck, in the remote unit here at the Irish McNeil Boys Club in Shreveport. I want to ask Oral Link, Boyd, if he'll stay tuned. If we run out of airtime here and there's no decision, let's do something that's never been done. Oral Link, stay tuned, record this, tape this, and next week we'll show the fans at home. We'll keep this and show back whatever happens in this contest if there's not a victory by the time we finish here today. Forearm smash by DiBiase, 30 seconds left. DiBiase, oh, you can hear that kick clear over here, Boyd Pierce, and Wrestling 2 is really pouring the coals to Ted DiBiase, the one of the toughest.
We want to keep the cameras rolling. We'll show it to you next week. Our time's gone. Remember, Captain Redneck, Dick Murdoch, and Mike Sharp against DiBiase and Dugan. Next week, Bob Roop, our guest commentator. For Bill Watts, I'm Boyd Pearson. Goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling. Hello, wrestling fans, and welcome to Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. I'm your host, Boyd Pearson. We have a lot of exciting action coming up this week. We'll see Kamala, the Ugandan giant, back in action. Also, Colonel Buck Robley against Mask Grappler number 2. Tag team action sees Captain Redneck, Dick Murdoch, and Iron Mike Sharp take on Ted DiBiase and Hacksaw Dugan. The Mid-South Tag Team Champions are here, the Junkyard Dog and Mr. Olympia. Somebody else is here this week as our guest commentator, 3 times holder of AAU Championship, a great former collegiate athlete at the University of Southern Illinois. And talk about athlete and a champion, he also is former holder of the Louisiana state title and a North American heavyweight belt. That's Bob Roop in the past, Bob Roop in the present. I know you've just returned from a vacation in Ohio and Michigan up in the east. And I'd like to ask you, what about your plans now that you're back, Bob?
Well, let me answer that question and not answer too, Boyd. I just returned from my second vacation. I recently spent a few weeks out in Denver, Colorado area in the mountains out there, trying to kind of relax after a year on the tour here. And, you know, one of the reasons I like being a professional wrestler is because of the fact I'm self-employed and I can take my vacations when I want to, and I can afford to go anywhere in the world I want. And you're right, recently I just came back from Michigan. My parents live in Michigan. And as far as I'm willing to tell you that, Boyd, but no lack of respect, but as far as my future plans, no competitor in professional sports will tell anybody about his future plans if he calls himself smart. And you know as well as I do, as I was known as the man with the million-dollar brain. And one other thing, Boyd, wrestlers all across the world are wondering when Bob Roop is going to step back in the ring again, and I'm certainly not going to let anybody know. So, again, no hard feelings. If you don't mind, let's just keep things formal.
All right, I respect that. Last week when we left you, it was Mr. Wrestling 2 and Ted DiBiase in the ring. Our time ran out, but we kept the camera rolling as we promised. So let's see what happened last week here after our time ran out on television. Let's watch it right now.
1 minute airtime left. Boyd Pierce, this contest, I want to ask Oral Link, who's back here in the truck, in the remote unit here at the Irish McNeil Boys Club in Shreveport. I want to ask Oral Link, Boyd, if he'll stay tuned. If we run out of airtime here and there's no decision, let's do something that's never been done. Oral Link, stay tuned, record this, tape this, and next week we'll show the fans at home. We'll keep this and show back whatever happens in this contest if there's not a victory by the time we finish here today. Forearm smash by DiBiase, 30 seconds left. DiBiase, oh, you can hear that kick clear over here, Boyd Pierce. And Wrestling 2 is really pouring the coals to Ted DiBiase, the one of the toughest.
We want to keep the cameras rolling. We'll show it to you next week. Our time's gone. Remember, Captain Redneck, Dick Murdoch, and Mike Sharp against DiBiase and Duggan. Next week, Bob Roop, my guest commentator. For Bill Watts, I'm Boyd Pierce. Goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling.
Wrestler 2 almost had the fall on DiBiase. We've got Oral Link, and his floor director, Paul White, has told us the cameras are still running. We're going to commentate this. We're not on the air at this point, but we're saving this. We are planning on showing you this battle, this challenge match, for once is going to go to a finish. DiBiase is not going to get away with taunting and challenging people. Hacksaw Duggan, you see the fan stand of Hacksaw Duggan. He's coming in to try to measure Wrestler 2. But two was warned by the crowd and has met Hacksaw Duggan face on. Wrestling 2, a man standing alone against two of the toughest men in wrestling. And you can see him fighting out there, and Duggan, a big, powerful man, catches him from behind. They've got the North American champion and one of the most rugged men in wrestling. They've got Wrestling 2 down out there. The two of them have him. DiBiase punishing him, Duggan punishing him. Two is down, DiBiase is. Crowd is hollering for JYD. They're double arm whipping him into the ropes. He popped DiBiase with that knee lift.
Both of them.
Wrestling 2, he had to reach down and pull it out on his own. He knocked DiBiase out there. Now he's firing away at Hacksaw Duggan. Wrestler 2 has got him separated. He's back in control a little bit. Duggan went for the spear. Duggan missed the spear. But Wrestler 2 didn't miss with that knee lift. And he's really popped Duggan. DiBiase coming from behind. Wrestler 2 caught him in the solar plexus. He's popping him. Listen to the people holler. Two, two, two. This shows you why this man has been so great. And he catches him another great knee lift. Wrestler 2 stood him up, and he popped him again. And DiBiase and Duggan coming back. Will he get there in time? One, two, three.
A tremendous athlete, Bill.
I don't think Duggan wanted it anymore.
Tremendous athlete, Mr. Wrestling 2, with his hand raised in the air to the delight of the fans.
And DiBiase and Duggan, look at them leave. They've been whipped. They've been whipped by that man right there, Wrestler 2. Look at the crowd, two, two, two.
You know, Boyd, after watching this, even as a contingency plan, I have to say that Ted DiBiase had himself pretty well covered, and the very fact that Mr. Wrestling Number 2 was able to not only take care of Ted DiBiase, but Hacksaw Duggan, and then go ahead and beat DiBiase, I got to hand it to the man. He is double tough.
And we'll be back to Mid-South Wrestling after this important message. Another great battle last week was between Colonel Buck Robley and General Skandar Akbar, and since Killer Khan and 454-pound one-man gang was barred from the building, Bill Watts and I thought it would be a one-against-one confrontation in that ring. And then we saw the appearance of Kamala, the Ugandan giant, and we said, that's the man that Skandar Akbar has brought here to be in his stable. But that proved wrong, because out of the clear blue, right in the middle of that match between Colonel Buck Robley and General Skandar Akbar, burst on the scene the Mongolian Stomper. Let's watch that happening right now.
He's got the sleeper. Buck's got the sleeper on Akbar. The people applauding. They know that Buck Robley's got the sleeper on Skandar Akbar. Somebody just ran by.
Went by the table, Bill.
The man's in a sheepskin jacket. He's attacking Buck Robley from behind. Apparently, Skandar Akbar again has used those Ben Franklins to hire another assassin. And that one is the Mongolian Stomper, the man managed by Carson. And he has attacked Colonel Buck Robley from behind. Double chop. And he picks Robley up. And there's that hold of his, the Shinonomaki, which is a form of sleeper, just as the one Buck has, by this powerful man, this unscrupulous, heartless individual, the Mongolian Stomper. There Jesse Barr comes to his rescue. Stomper knocked Jesse Barr off. Vinnie Romeo, Mike Bond. Look at this man decimate these troops that have come to try to help Colonel Robley. And Skandar Akbar has apparently reached out into those purse strings and found another vicious, unscrupulous animal to do his bidding.
That battle ended in a disqualification, but all of us as wrestling fans know that when Colonel Buck Robley and General Skandar Akbar are involved, the feud never ends. Right now, Akbar has the Mongolian Stomper in the ring. Let's go for the introduction of this event.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 270 pounds, General Skandar Akbar proudly presents the Mongolian Stomper. And in the blue corner at 245 pounds from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike Bond.
Mike Bond in the black tights and the Mongolian Stomper, the man you saw a while ago that burst upon the scene last week during a match between Akbar and Colonel Buck Robley, is his opponent. Bob Roop.
Well, again, boy, the Mongolian Stomper, he was a surprise last week. Everybody's well aware of him this week, and in the interim, you can see him going right on the attack. But one of the inside bits of information is that one of the largest sums of money passed hands between Skandar Akbar and the former manager of the Mongolian Stomper, one Don Carson, that has ever been recorded as far as buying a wrestling contract. Ooh, he stomped him right to the head. I can see why they call this man the Stomper. Well, I'm familiar with the Mongolian Stomper. I've watched him campaign before. He's vicious. Full backhand chop. It looked like it caught him right between the eyes from here. He is just, Mike Bond has not been on the offensive at all. In fact, he hasn't really even had time to get on the defensive. He is just getting beat up. And that's one thing that has stayed true about the Stomper. His style has remained the same. He is a punisher. Mongolia has a great background of amateur wrestling. And I know this man knows the scientific style, but I don't think he considers it part of his repertoire. Now, Mike Bond's showing some resilience here. He was able to come back from a pretty good beating. It looks like he lost his, a lot of times what might save you in a case like that is losing your temper, or maybe you realize that you're getting beat up so bad you're gonna get hurt and put out of action completely. Now the Stomper, I don't know, he gives the impression that he wasn't hurt very much by Mike Bond's retaliation there. I see some reddened areas on his abdomen, but as far as showing any effect from the vicious stomp right to the midsection. That's legal. He doesn't kick below the belt. Ooh, he goes for a full body slam and press. Now again, he apparently is not going to waste any time. Again, working on that midsection with stomps, kicks. Again, a back full backhand chop. Apparently he is, now he's going for the Shinigomaki. I've seen him use this for a long time now. Very effective variation of the sleeper. And you see how fast Mike Bond went to sleep.
Rick Ferreira calls for the bell. Mike Bond is out to the delight of General Skandar Akbar, the Mongolian stopper. Racks up a victory. We'll be back. It's Colonel Buck Robley versus grappler number two after this important message from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 240 pounds, from parts unknown, grappler number two. And in the blue corner at 242 pounds from Amarillo, Texas, Colonel Buck Robley.
The masked grappler number two in the long black tights and the familiar silver and black mask against the man in the yellow shirt. Nobody calls me yellow, Colonel Buck Robley. Bob Roop.
Well, at one time it was YB Robley, Yellow Belly, and I guess he changed his tune, or, but he can back it up. I'm not going to detract from the man. He's very unorthodox style. He can wrestle. He's a lot stronger than he looks. He knows his way around a wrestling ring. His opponent, grappler two, I am not very familiar with. I know he's hooked up with a very fine partner. Well, what's this now? Appearing on ringside now, Mike Sharp and Mr. Wrestling Two.
Well, Bob Roop, I think one of the reasons you see Mike Sharp and Mr. Wrestling Two there, during this match, you have Colonel Buck Robley and grappler two, and recently we've seen Robley and some of the others double-crossed, jumped on, and some of the wrestlers here on Mid-South are fed up, and they intend to see that a battle remains one-on-one confrontation. So that's the only thing I know that could be the reason for Iron Mike Sharp and Mr. Wrestling Two to be on the scene, and they're on the outside of the ring.
Well, I know Wrestling Two wants to get some of his face back at that he lost from the grappler, kind of embarrassing him, making a fool out of him a little bit. And, you know, it's interesting that the grappler two now here on the offensive, taking it to Buck Robley. Looks like Robley is poking at his eyes. Maybe that mask is giving him some protection. Robley reverses it. But grappler, and you can just see it on your screen now. Grappler one is down there looking like he might want to offer some advice or whatever. He told me himself that the reason he took a partner was because he wanted somebody to watch his back, because there's nobody you can trust in wrestling. It looks like this is a case of what he said is really proved out here, because Robley obviously has these men down there to watch his back. I can't imagine them coming down on their own just to sit there or stand there and watch the match. So obviously they're down there for that purpose. Grappler one is showing a great deal of displeasure at the fact that if he did want to interfere, apparently he has had second thoughts. Mike Sharp walking around now to face him. The match in the ring has slowed down somewhat with the external. You know, a situation like this is a great chance for something to actually go on in the ring. Grappler could be just trying to distract Buck Robley, but in this case, that's not proven out either. Robley's perhaps too smart for that. He went right to an arm drag, has grappler two down, and continues to bring pressure on that left arm, chest, and thorax area, making the man carry his weight, keeping himself in a lateral position at the side. Now, grappler two comes up, and he's smart. He knows how quick he got up right away. He knows he's behind strategically, and in this case, Robley has got the advantage. Grappler two took right over on him. Now he's going, this is sort of a show me type match, because each man is attacking the other man in the same area. Left arm, left shoulder. Right now I'd have to say that neither man has shown a clear cut edge. Robley showed some agility, going up to a head scissors. Did he keep the arm lever? I can't see from here. No, he released the arm, but still, he's still putting pressure. His legs is obviously be stronger than your arms. Putting pressure on that neck and thorax. Cuts off the breathing. It's not a chokehold, but it's uncomfortable. Anybody with any, even a tinge of claustrophobia would hate being in that kind of position. But grappler two showing some strength there. Comes out of it. Didn't get up quick enough that time. Robley, again showing why he's considered one of the nastiest professionals in the sport. He's got him on Dream Street right now. Knees wobbling.
And Raptor 1 would like nothing better than come to the aid of his oftentimes partner, but there he sees between him and the ring, Mr. Wrestling 2 and Iron Mike Sharp to keep him away.
Well, Robley is going to have clear on obstruction to either beat the man or get beat. He doesn't have him beat yet. I know the grappler isn't going to take on any partner that can't handle himself. He's done all right so far. Robley, when he hit him with that head stomp a while back, was when it was a turning point because of the fact he disorientated him. He's had him just, he's going for the sleeper now. Unless he comes out of this right away, Boyd, it's over. Because I haven't seen him fail to put anybody to sleep with that yet, unless there was interference. And it looks like it's going to work for him again in this case. Yep, he's got him.
Indeed it does, and it's a victory for Colonel Buck Robley. Exciting tag team action following. It'll be Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch and Iron Mike Sharp against Ted DiBiase and Hacksaw Duggan when we return after this word from Mid-South.
It's tag team action now for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 265 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, the North American heavyweight champion Ted DiBiase. And his partner at 270 pounds from New York City, Hacksaw Duggan. Pounds from Waxahachie, Texas, Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch. And his partner at 287 pounds from Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, the Louisiana heavyweight champion, Iron Mike Sharp.
Tag team action now being introduced. Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch from Texas, the city of Waxahachie, 37 miles south of Dallas, and his partner, the great professional athlete from north of the border of Canada, Louisiana champion Iron Mike Sharp. Rick Ferreira calls the bell, and their opponents from New York State, the foot stomping Hacksaw Duggan, and his partner, the current North American heavyweight title holder, Ted DiBiase. A lot of action coming up, Bob.
What a great match, boy. I don't know too many wrestling promotions anywhere in the world that'll put on their top competitors in the ring at the same time. And
especially
again,
on television for
on
the
television,
fans to see.
Of course. And here you got a real combination. Season. Now, there's Dick Murdoch. I heard a story about him just the other day. Somebody apparently in one of his honky-tonk clubs insulted him as a professional wrestler, called him a coward and jumped on him, and I guess he had to put the guy in the hospital. But Murdoch will tell you about the time. Ask him about Bob Roop in Miami. I put a knot on his head. Took about 6 months to disappear. And Ted DiBiase tried to put another one, but Murdoch, he wasn't quite quick enough. Murdoch got out of the way. I'm always amazed at the speed and agility of guys this size. But then you got look at that. Flying head scissors. Ooh. That's one of those honky-tonk moves. Elbow right between the eyes. Hacksaw Duggan, he likes it. He says he likes it as tough and as rough and as mean and as dirty as he can get it. And Mike Sharp is not known as being a particularly vicious wrestler, but Dick Murdoch will give him all that he wants. Mike Sharp is a tremendously strong, oh, imagine a man 280 pounds, a standing drop kick, and the speed, again, combined with that strength.
Iron Mike Sharp fired up, being halted by referee Rick Pereira, slowed him down, but Hacksaw Duggan, now the aggressor.
Hacksaw caught him coming in, Boyd. He caught him with a foot to the midsection. And Mike Sharp now is coming back. He's not using his feet. Those big paws of his are enough. He ran Hacksaw right into Dick Murdoch's side, number 12 boot. Murdoch, head chancery. Hey, Hacksaw got over the corner. Murdoch allowed himself to get trapped in there. That's unusual for him. Giving Ted DiBiase five or six good shots at him. He's replaying him with those elbows now. Hey, DiBiase caught him with a big backdrop. And when you're Murdoch's size, 270 plus, and you go from about 7 or 8 feet in the air down flat on your back, you know, people talk about being able to land right. Well, if you don't, you break a hip. Now, oh, excuse me, boy, they had a two count there, and Murdoch was able to come out of it. DiBiase going again, and it gave Murdoch too much time to recover. One danger in doing a move twice is you tell him the first time what you might be going to do again. DiBiase tags out Hacksaw Duggan and Mike Sharp. Back into it. Dropping those knees on the hamstring muscles will give you an instant Charlie horse, especially when you go and stretch that hamstring right back out. You can see the difficulty that Hacksaw Duggan is having. Ooh, plucked him right out of that corner. Said, come here. Well, Duggan was able to recover enough to, this man likes it rough. Look at him now, he's stomping him. Only man kicked out of pro football for being too dirty. I find that very interesting. Now he's putting it to him now. He has a very rough style, unorthodox, but you might say it's a diamond in the rough because it's effective. DBICN taking advantage of the situation, puts a boot to him. All right, it was reversed. DiBiase's not going to let that momentum go. Raked the eyes prior to taking him, shoving him in that turnbuckle. They're working on the arm. Try to pinch those nerves up in the shoulder and neck area.
And you know, on the outside of the ring, Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch doesn't like anything about what's going on and happening to his partner inside that ring.
Well, that's true, boy. But Murdoch always says he threatens to beat up partners that come in and save him. So I don't think you're going to see him. Oh, shoulder breaker. Again. Oh, look at the power of that Mike Sharp to come out of that. Now, Hacksaw Duggan, I would only give him about a 6 on a 10 scale on that shoulder breaker, but still, they've been working on that arm, and that's something that really pinches those nerves up there and almost immobilizes the whole side of the body. They're tagging in and out. Now, DiBiase went to the well once too often there and allowed him to tag. They had Mike Sharp going pretty good. And now, like you said a minute ago, Boyd, Dick Murdoch did not like that. And now he's repeating one of Duggan's tactics, that boot to the midsection. It looked like he caught him on the throat on that with that punch. Elbow to the back of the neck. He's going to whip him in that turnbuckle. DiBiase reverses it. Catches him with a right cross coming out. DiBiase has really picked up some polish. Oh, he gave him too much time. Everybody in the studio audience jumped to their feet on that one. Murdoch came up off the floor on that one. That switched the momentum just unbelievably. Murdoch has got DiBiase. Well, Ted is showing some ability here. Yep, leapfrog. Oh, Murdoch countered him. Again, 270 and 250 coming down together on the back of Ted DiBiase's shoulders. And Murdoch went for the pin. When DiBiase managed to kick out, Murdoch showing that ring generalship that he has always possessed, even as a very young wrestler. DiBiase showing he's got youth on his side and a stamina, but he's definitely showing it here. But, oh, Murdoch managed to bull him all the way out of that corner. I haven't seen that. DiBiase made a mistake here. Mike Sharp is a very quiet man, but once he's aroused, watch out. He's got them both now. Using those partners against each other. Well, Murdoch's not going to let him fight two men alone. Referee's pitting Murdoch out. Sharp, oh! Hacksaw Duggan speared him right in the side of the head. Unbelievable move. Sharp is down. Murdoch back into the action. Knocks Duggan outside. Ted DiBiase getting up, adjusting that controversial glove. As Sharp gets up, knocks him. Looks like he knocked him out, Boyd. One, two, three.
Looked like Ted DiBiase did more than adjust it, Bob Roop, but it gains a victory for his team. And we'll be back and see Kamala, the Ugandan giant, in action after this message from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the blue corner, at 238 pounds from New York City, Vinny Romeo. And coming into the ring right now, a very awesome sight indeed in the red corner. At 6 feet, 8 inches of height, 385 pounds, Kamala, the Ugandan giant.
Well, Bob Roop, we had to hold on to our headsets across our ears as the roll of the drums of the Ugandan giant in the form of Kamala. There you see his assistant, his handler, whatever it could be. I don't believe he was right to be called handler for this big man. In the ring with him, and of course his opponent in the red tights waiting is Vinny Romeo, as Jerry Usher, the referee, watches on and gets ready to call for the bell when the handler and his assistant, there you can see him take off his arms. Now off comes the mask. Now comes the jewelry from around his neck.
You know, boy, this can't help but be intimidating. The man is savage enough as an appearance without, like you say, the mask, the jewelry, the appendages, and things that he has. He's got a ring in his nose.
And powerful and awesome is the word. There goes the spear, and here comes the bell, Bob.
Well, again, this man is, ooh, look at the power. He just took, without any scientific hold at all, he just grabs him by the neck and flings him to the mat.
He not only can gain a victory or beat somebody, he destroys them, Bob Roop.
Vinny Romeo just completely, the man just shrugged off two drop kicks. He is powerful. You know, again, very intimidating, those chops, but not only that, but nobody knows anything about this man except his handler. I don't know anything about him, and I know everything about professional wrestlers, but if you go to scout this man, there's not much you can scout. You don't know his weak points. Unless he does something in the ring, and all he's been doing in the ring since he's been at Mid-South is beating people up, and the matches haven't lasted very long. Ooh, he picked him up like a small sack of potatoes and just shook him and just threw him down. He pats himself. Ooh! Do not lie down on the job against this man, but oh, look at that. That horizontal body smash.
And the viciousness and crushing tactics gains another victory for the Ugandan giant, Kamala.
He is impressive.
The Mid-South Tag Team Champion, Junkyard Dog, and Mr. Olympian action when we return after this message.
It's tag team action now in a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 270 pounds from Vancouver, British Columbia, Kelly Kaniski. And his partner, at 240 pounds from Charlotte, North Carolina, Bob Stabler. South Tag Team Champions, 265 pounds from Tennessee, the Junkyard Dog, and his partner at 242 pounds, Mr. Olympia.
Tag Team action now continues on Mid-South Wrestling. Rick Pereira calls for the bell. It's Kelly Kaniski and Bob Stabler against the Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Mr. Olympia, and the People's Choice, the Junkyard Dog.
Well, Kelly Kaniski showing some grace and style there, sweeping sort of a leg sweep. He started from too far out, but there he goes again. He's giving him a little bit too much warning. Of course, you're dealing with Mr. Olympia, a man with very, very good reflexes, as well as that. Well, Olympia was a little more direct. He went right to it. Kaniski kicked him off, hip throw, kick off, arm drag. Both these men, quick. Thinking on their feet. Bob Stabler jerked down into an arm drag. I see why they call it an arm drag. Junkyard Dog comes in there. Oh, he's powerful. As well built and developed as Mr. Olympia is, Junkyard Dog just really makes just about anybody. I'm glad I'm not into muscle building. I'd be jealous. Good tagging in and out here. Bob Stabler has not seen any daylight at all since he tagged into the ring. Ooh, plop right on his face that time. He's looked like he's trying to scramble to his corner. He better get out of there before he, ooh, clothesline. Beautiful tag team action. I can see why these men were the champions. And again, ooh, that what he calls a thump. Olympia there to keep out any interference.
And the Mid-South Tag Team title holders, Junkyard Dog and Mr. Olympia, gain another victory to their long wins. And we'll be back. More action coming up on Mid-South Wrestling after this message.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 218 pounds from Knoxville, Tennessee, Tim Horner. And in the blue corner at 236 pounds from Portland, Oregon, Jesse Barr.
Tim Horner in the green against the red and blue tight-clad Jesse Barr as action continues on Mid-South.
You know, Boyd, Jesse Barr, as far as I'm concerned, is a man, unless he gets a serious injury, one that ends his career, he is a can't-miss as a big, big star in professional wrestling. He's got everything he needs except experience. Now, I don't want to take anything away from Tim Horner because I was just going to say the same thing about him. He has not progressed as far as Jesse Barr, but he is another can't miss. I saw him take a bad beating a while back, and he showed he can come back. He's resilient. He's got a lot of fire. Again, lack of experience. There's no substitute for it.
And Bob Roop, the Junkyard Dog, and Mr. Olympia, the Mid-South champion, never looked better than they did in the match just previous to this one. Kamala, the Ugandan giant, continued his destroying his opponents in the ring. Captain Redneck, Dick Murdoch, Iron Mike Sharp, Ted DiBiase, Hacksaw Duggan, Colonel Buck Robley. Are they all here? Mr. Wrestling, too. It could only mean the Superdome is coming on Thanksgiving night in New Orleans. All the top stars coming to the Mid-South area. We want all our fans to join us there. I've never missed a one since we had all the extravaganzas, and this Turkey Day will be no different as I have Thanksgiving dinner with my family and then fly into the Crescent City of New Orleans to see all of our fans all over the area. You don't have to be in New Orleans. All the adjoining towns in the states, we invite you to be there. It'll be a tremendous crowd, a tremendous card as always on the Superdome. You're talking about something else. Next week, Chavo Guerrero, the fine Latin star, will be here on Mid-South Wrestling. But 2 weeks, listen to this, Bob Roop, and listen to this, wrestling fan, a showdown here on Mid-South Wrestling Television for the Mid-South Tag Team Championship. Ted DiBiase and Hacksaw Duggan in the ring against the Junkyard Dog and Mr. Olympia in the showdown battle. They're trying to get, it hasn't been signed, but they're trying to get a loser of the fall would have to leave Mid-South Wrestling for 60 days. That clause they want to put into that. That's 2 weeks from now on Mid-South Wrestling, that battle. Right now, Jesse Barr and Tim Horner continue in the ring. Bob?
Well, I've been watching, Boyd. I'm listening to your comments, of course. I've been watching, and this match is fairly evenly matched. Again, neither of these men have shown any viciousness as far as rule breaking, trying to take any shortcuts. And as far as your comments, Boyd, I have to admit that big Superdome card wouldn't be quite the same without you down there announcing those main events. Again, a lot of action in this match. And one other comment, I have to reiterate what you said, that as far as tag wrestling, two teams really impressed me today. Junkyard Dog and Mr. Olympia, I mean, that was perfection. And as far as being able to adjust to situations, Ted DiBiase and Hacksaw Duggan certainly were able to, with two top opponents, they were able to come up with a variety of different ploys and moves to pull a victory out of that match against two very tough opponents, Louisiana champion Mike Sharp and Dick Murdoch, Captain Redneck. And again, back to the match, evenly matched. It's, in a way, it's hard. These men are showing a lot of ability and skill and a lot of psychology out there, but it's hard to follow some of the great action that we've been privileged to sit here and see today on Mid-South. And the fans, too, every kind
1 minute left, 1 minute 60 seconds. Time remaining of television time.
Well, these men better gear it up if they want to get a win on TV. And like you said, boy, the wrestlers are all here. They're asking. They're going after matchmaker Grizzly Smith, probably waiting on his front doorstep in the morning saying, get me on television before that Superdome. And I might be doing that myself sometime soon. Tim Horner, counter. Jesse Barsh hangs on to it. Again, they're going to have to step up the pace a little bit.
30 seconds as the clock continues to run and our time just about gone. Remember, next week, Chavo Guerrero will be here. In 2 weeks, a big showdown for the Mid-South Tag Team title. Ted DiBiase and Hacksaw Duggan versus Junkyard Dog and Mr.
Close
Olympia.
Close to a fall, Boyd, excuse me. I've got a two count there. I thought we might get a fall.
Time's running. Bob Roop, thanks so much for your expert commentary. Until next week, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I'm Boyd Pierce saying goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. Thank you so much for watching.